Hi, I'm Mike McLean. Welcome to the Short Circuit podcast, brought to you by Swift Aircraft. In this series, we'll be chatting with a variety of people from all walks of life, but who all have one thing in common: aviation. We'll discuss how and why they got into aviation, what or who inspired them, and what they would say to encourage young people to get involved. Flight fascinates many of us, and our guests will explain why they are compelled to look to the sky. Today's guest is Chris Milnes. Chris is an aviation enthusiast with a passion, not only for flying, but for all aspects of aviation, and for passing that knowledge on to the younger generation. We first met on a windy airfield in Northamptonshire a few years ago, and I was struck by his energy and obvious love of what he was doing. He has a fascinating story to tell, but we can only just scratch the surface here today. Also, for some of those who aren't familiar with all the aviation jargon, Chris does mention two things. One, PPL, which stands for Private Pilot's License, and two, tail dragger, which is an old-fashioned style of undercarriage for aircraft with two big wheels at the front and one little wheel at the back. I'm sure you'll be familiar with that. So without further ado, let's join the discussion here on the Short Circuit. Good afternoon, Mr. Chris Milne. How are you today?
Good afternoon, Mike McLean. Long time no see, and I'm very well, thank you.
It's been far too long. And so I'm going to kick off with our standard number one question. And that is, who are you? And when I say that, I mean, how do you fit into the aviation world here in the UK?
Okay, well, who am I? I'm a very bog-standard PPL, but with a sort of fairly quirky, strange, but often very familiar start within my flying sort of career. Long story short, I live in Leeds. I'm rapidly approaching 60 years old. Married to Jules. I have a little dog called Daisy, who's a Springer Spaniel. But more importantly, I am fortunate enough to fly airplanes. My aviation hobby or career, however you want to phrase it, has spanned some 40 years, or 40 plus years. I actually got into aviation at the age of 15. How this happened, very long story short, but I come from, basically, I lived in a council estate in Leeds, which is quite a rough place to say the least. I was in a middle school in a very bog standard kind of education. But my dad one day introduced me to a guy called Ken Mason. Because my dad knew that I had a passion for aeroplanes. The passion for aeroplanes I discovered as a child watching television with programs like Flambards, which you probably have never heard of. But it was, it was a BBC show. And it was like, it's basically the early years of pioneer aviation in the UK, literally. From the 1903s and onwards. So it was a it was about the very first pilots, or aviators as they were called in those days. And I saw these people in these canvas and wooden string aircraft doing incredible things and building things, which was a massive thing to me, watching them build this on this show. The show was a drama, but it was very factual in the way it presented vintage aircraft. So it really captured my imagination. The other program that captured my imagination at the time as being a child was a program called Sailor, which is about the HMS Ark Royal. Mm-hmm. Which, if you know it for nothing else, it was for the theme tune done by Rod Stewart, which was pretty awful, but very, very catchy. So, well, this was the other end of the scale. This was, I think, F4 Phantoms going off the Ark Royal at great speed and showing the super flyboys that I could clearly never aspire to be. Mm-hmm. And in fact, in my childhood, I never thought it'd be anything other than just somebody who came off a council estate and got a job maybe as a bin man or something like that. It turned out quite differently. As I said, my father introduced me to a guy called Ken Mason. Ken Mason, although it's an English name, was actually a Polish guy. He was a Polish free pilot who was a navigator in Halifax bombers in World War II. I never actually found out what his Polish name was. But at the age of, I think, 13 or 14, something like that, I really can't remember, he took me for a flight from an airfield called Sherburn in Elmet, which is just near Leeds to where I live. He picked me up from the council flat, drove me there, stuck me in his Rolleston Condor, which is a tail dragger aircraft, which when we were on the floor, I couldn't actually see over the nose because at that point it was about 4'11". and we took off. And then after about 5 minutes, he gave me the controls of this aircraft and told me what to do. But 5 minutes later, I was doing turns to the left and to the right, and I was climbing and descending, and to sort of great praise from this mountain of a man with a big long red beard who was quite he was bonkers. He was mad as a box of frogs, but one of the nicest people you could ever meet. That created a very early desire to want to learn to fly. But as I mentioned, without going on about it too much, my background was extremely humble. I was still living in a council flat. My father couldn't hold down a job. My mother was scraping enough just to keep the household going. And so I was expected to bring a bit of income into the household, even at a young age. So at 14, I had two paper rounds. At the age of 15, I had a paper round and I was filling shelves at Asda. Then, about when I was well, just around the age of 15, Ken took me once more to do something different. It took me to a gliding club near York called the Walls Gliding Club. And he said, if you want to learn to fly, which I'd mentioned I did want to do, he says, this is an affordable way of doing it. Back then, it was very affordable. These days, not so much. I remember, I think it was a fiver launch for a winch launch, and then something like 6 pence a minute to go up in a K7 or a K10 or a K13. And that triggered something. That really triggered something. So at the age of 16, again, not amounting to much, I got a job as an apprentice joiner, which would actually gave me a really good start in life in terms of growing up. And with the money that I earned as an apprentice joiner, I bought a little 50cc motorbike, and my Sundays were getting on the motorbike, going from Leeds to York to Pocklington, and being a hangar rat. And I would help out in the airfield. I would do all the jobs, all the duties there. At the end of the day, I would always be given at least one free flight, and then if I could afford it, I'd stick another one on the back of that. And shortly after my 16th birthday, about 2 days after I think it was, I actually went solo for the first time.
Oh, well.
And that's how I got into flying. And the rest is, I mean, I could tell you the whole story if you wish, but the rest is over the next 30 years.
Well, we'll work our way through. We'll work our way through. So your initial inspiration was this chap Ken, who took you up
Very much so,
and
yeah.
gave you the controls, and that was it. You had control, something you learned that I can fly, and you wanted to do more of it. So, okay, that's a very good gateway. That's a stroke of luck, maybe. But obviously, inspiration coming from a mentor. So,
Absolutely, absolutely.
I also know that over time that you got involved with the cadets as well. So the ATC, the Air Training Corps. So how did that happen, and what attracted you into getting into the cadets? I mean, why do that?
How it happened. So, fast forward many years later, and I was flying a vintage Piper Cub J3, 1946 hand swung Piper Cub that belonged to a guy called Adam. I'll just leave it there. He was another madman. For some reason, I seem to keep meeting madmen. And for the cost of the fuel, he allowed me to fly this Piper Cub from an airfield near York. One day, I got a phone call from him. He said, Chris, Adam, I need you to do me a favor. What's that? He said, I've got this chap called so-and-so. He's a tail dragger pilot and wants to buy into the Piper Cub. And now, could you check him out? I said, well, I'm not really an instructor. I'm not really qualified to check him out. He says, my airplane, you fly it perfectly well. Just go with him and see what you think and report back to me, which was perfectly legal and perfectly legitimate. So this chap came along, strong Geordie accent, hello. I introduced himself, and we went flying, and his landing was a dream. His flying was a dream, a proper stick and rudder man. And for people who don't understand what that means, when you have a tail dragger aircraft, although you've got the control column that operates the ailerons, which is the roll, quite often with a tail dragger and lots of aircraft, you have to coordinate that with the rudder pedals as well to create clean turns. But also, it's how you steer the aircraft on the floor, and it's how you counteract crosswinds and drift and things like that. His landing was superb. I said, you've got a lot of tail dragger experience, haven't you? He said, yeah. He said, I've got about 700 hours in tail draggers. Oh, blimey, right. Where have you got all that? He says, I'm an instructor with Air Cadets. And I went, are you Royal Air Force then? Because, of course, everybody imagines that instructors in any kind of air corps must be Royal Air Force. He said, no, I'm a software engineer in Tyneside. I said, what? He says, yeah, I'm a software engineer. I said, well, how are you flying for the Air Cadets? He says, I'm a civilian instructor. With a volunteer gliding squadron. Also, the glider says, no, he says they're not. They're a powered aircraft called a Vigilant, which is a Grob 109B. He says, but because we're a gliding squadron, we treat it as a motor glider. So although we teach power, we call ourselves a gliding squadron. I said, so can anybody do that? He says, yeah, if they're a good tail dragger pilot. Don't suppose you could give me any names. And he gave me two names, and I rang them the very same day, the first one. And again, long story short, 2 weeks later, I was interviewed at RAF Linton on News by a guy who became my squadron leader. And I went on then to serve 7 years operating the Vigilant Group 109B. I then acquired about 500 hours, and I turned out as a B1 category instructor, which is teaching the whole ab initio from the very first trip to the first solo. A strange quirk of that is when I say first solo, it was actually the second solo, because on the first solo, it had to be an A or an A star instructor or above that could actually send a kid on the first solo. What I discovered during that time is not just my passion for aviation, but my passion to pass it on. And I started working with young people, and I was absolutely, having come from a council estate in Leeds, I was astounded how many more council estate kids were in the cadets and wanted to learn to fly. And I was helping them. And that's how I got into that. And it's to this day, it improved me immensely in terms of my empathy, my abilities, my instruction capabilities. But more than anything else, it gave me such a great deal of faith in a much maligned part of our population, which is the youth. And the youth of this country were then and still are full of so much potential and so much ability and so much promise, but we're just doing nothing to get out of them.
Do you find when you're interacting with young people that when you're not teaching so much in a formal sense, but you're passing on, as you say, you're passing on your knowledge, do you find that's that sense of fulfillment is much greater than you would imagine?
I
Because,
think it's the most fulfilling thing I've ever done,
yeah.
apart from possibly becoming a dad. I say that in case my kids are listening. But generally, for me to, you're not putting something back into it, you're actually getting more out of it, if that makes sense.
Oh,
And I think that's the way I described it a few years ago, and it's absolutely true. Because when you talk to anybody about flying, the first thing a lot of people that meet for the first time think, this guy's got an ego. This guy's going to just walk into a room and say, how do you know when a pilot walks into the room? He'll tell you. But we're not, some of us are not like that. Some of us just really have a passion for actually just for aviating, not for being a 737 pilot or flying up, some kind of microchip, but for actually passing on the skills of aviation and the history of it and the passion for it. And the joys and the freedoms of it. And that's what's really important to me. Because I see kids that come back from a trip in a Viking and they've got a big grin on their face. And do you enjoy that? Yeah, I absolutely love that, sir. That'll do. What more do you need on? And then when you go home on a Sunday afternoon after having a busy day running around doing whatever you're doing, you think about those moments. You don't think about anything else.
Right. Okay. So I'm going to come to the big one now. So we met quite a long time ago at an air show. Was it the LAA or was it Aero Expo? I can't remember which one it was.
It was we actually met at both of them, as it
Right. Oh,
happens.
okay. So
Initially, though, it was the LAA rally, and then we went to Air Expo the following year, I think it was.
right. So, and you were there. Well, I was there with Swift Aircraft and Europa Aircraft and running around trying to flog airplanes. And you were there with a strange outfit. And I want you to tell me the story of that outfit, who they are, what you did. So just go ahead.
Yep, happily. The outfit you're referring to was what we probably sort of label as a build a plane project called the Spirit of Goul. There have been a number of build a plane projects over the last few years, or the last few decades, in fact. But they've always, or tend to have been sponsored by either an aircraft manufacturer or a university or a college. And it's very much about getting a small bunch of people who are probably doing some kind of degree or aviation related thing that the build a plane project could give them somewhere towards their thesis or whatever they're trying to do. The Spirit Goul was very different. I mean, very briefly, how I got into it, I was actually stood on the apron at RAF Linton on the little green grow bag, taking cadets up in the Vigilant. And a chap approached me, and he was in civilian clothes, but I knew he'd arrived with the squadron. The squadron was from Goul, funny enough. Goul, for those who don't know, is a small, once thriving, but now very sort of unfortunately quite neglected town in East Yorkshire. This guy was called Jack, and he happened to have the same surname as me. I don't know whether that's what attracted him to me, but he was called Jack Milnes. He walked up and introduced himself, and he said, "It's something along the lines of my kids have really enjoyed flying with you today. How have you got on with them?" "They're fantastic. Yeah, you've got a good bunch of kids there. I've really enjoyed it. Thank you." He said, "I just want to talk to you about something." And he told me about this idea that he had. And the idea was to buy the absolutely stripped down kit for an aircraft called a Sherwood Ranger. What I mean by stripped down kit is there was no pre-build whatsoever. This was literally just a whole set of parts. If you can imagine an Airfix kit, but that's the size of a small football pitch when it's laid out, this is what a Sherwood Ranger kit is. And it was literally just a load of pieces of steel tube and pieces of wood and all the rest of it, a load of diagrams. And he wanted to take this project to Goole High School and introduce it to them, and assuming that they approved it, then recruit a big bunch of children from Goole High School to build this aircraft and then eventually go on to fly it. When he described it, it sounded absolutely mad. I didn't even know how he could even begin to put this together. But his passion was something that is quite unbridled. And you've met the guy himself. His enthusiasm for STEM, for engineering, for flying, for young people is incredible. He was a civilian instructor with young people because he was ex-forces himself. I think he was ex-RAF. And he knew the opportunities that aviation, discipline, building, and support could give to kids. And he'd seen the poverty and neglect that existed in Goole. And he could see that there was a potential synergy there to give a lot of people who would never, ever get anything like this in life and never get another chance to do something quite incredible. Little did I know that I would then spend the next 2 years walking around various air shows, various rallies, various steam fairs, various parents' evenings, and just banging on doors literally with a bucket and saying, "Can you put some money in this bucket?" Why would I do that? Well, it's because of this. It's this project that we have. And I became a trustee of the project quite quickly. I think one of the reasons I might have been recruited in the early days is my job at that point, and still is within sales. So when I have a product that I believe in, I'm actually quite passionate about selling it. And one good example of what I was doing, I was down at the same rally that I think you was at. We'd had some donations from various companies, one of which was Breitling. We had a very nice watch. But then we got this amazing leather jacket from a company whose name I can't remember. I do apologize. And Jack gave me a microphone and told me to stand up in front of 200 or 300 people and say, "Right, auction this jacket off." "You want me to what? What? What?" I was terrified, but I did exactly that. I went to the stage that's set up at the front. I nicked the microphone from the compere. Oh, sorry, I bought and I nudged the compere, said, "Excuse me, I've got this microphone. Can I just borrow 5 minutes of your time?" And within 10 minutes, we'd auctioned this leather jacket off for about £350. We'd auctioned it off to a really, really nice, incredible guy called Dave Sykes. Dave Sykes is a well-known disabled, or whatever the word is these days, disabled microlight flyer who has done flights around Europe. I think he's doing a flight up to Alaska in the near future. And he was good enough to spend £250 or £300 of his money on this jacket, which went directly into the fund. Other occasions, we would go to Air Expo or to other air rallies. And as the build started, we built a trailer, or the kids built a trailer for this aircraft. And we would take the part build from show to show to show and say, "Look at the progress we're making." Then we started getting celebrity endorsements. One of the endorsements was Carol Vorderman, who signed the wing spar of this aircraft, donated some money. It was very fortunate at the time she was dating one of the Red Arrows. So then we had two or three Red Arrows sign the wing spars. And then from that, suddenly a lot more interest came along. We, at the same time, we're going towards the public. We were going towards commercial sponsors to try and just get their logo on the aircraft. And we had logos. One was from Breitling, but one was from Almarad Tile Shop in Goole. There was two ends of the scale there, but they were both equally important. Fast forward then about 2.5 years, and at every stage of the build, as you know, when you're building aircraft, there has to be an inspection. So we had an LAA engineer called John Cook, who came regularly to inspect the aircraft. At one point in time, he said, "Right, this is fantastic. It's the best build I've ever seen, but you can't continue to build it where we were building it," which was in a classroom at Goole High School. Then we realized we made a bit of a problem for ourselves. We couldn't get it out of the classroom. We literally had to knock a wall down to get the fuselage and the folded wings out of the classroom. We had to rebuild the wall, put the window back, and then we just beggared off. And where did we go to? This is where life takes another amazing turn. The build was completed in Hangar 5 at Finningley, which is also known as Doncaster, Robin Hood, Sheffield Airport. In Hangar 5 was the then flying, only existing Vulcan bomber.
Wow.
We completed the build of this entire project underneath the wing of the Vulcan bomber at Hangar 5. And I want to tell you a little story about that. I've got 2 minutes for a little story about this.
Yeah, go ahead.
So one day we had an open day for the project in the hangar. I was halfway through my working day as a salesman, but Jack had asked me to turn up and man the stand, if you like. So I turned up and manned the stand, and I stood there in my work suit with my tie, all the rest of it. And I was shaking buckets and talking to the public that came through. And the public that coming through, they were coming through because the Vulcan Experience was trying to launch corporate days for entertainment under the wings of the Vulcan. So this could be anything from a company seminar to a wedding, as mad as that. And all these great and good were coming through. Anyway, these two gentlemen walked up to me in a sort of like, they were sort of smart casual and looked a little bit almost pensioner age. And they started asking me lots and lots of questions about the Sherwood Ranger aircraft that we were building. They were asking about the build, about the materials. They'd heard of Oratex, which is the coating that goes onto the aircraft, but the skin, if you like. I asked about the engine, and the engine was of particular interest to them. So I started explaining a little bit more about this engine, which was extremely light. When it had no fluids in it, it was only 45 kilos, and but it still turned out 95 horsepower. So it's a very efficient, light engine. And I said, "You guys know an awful lot about flying then. So what do you fly?" And they turned around, they pointed to the Vulcan bomber, and they went, "That." And I was speaking to Martin Withers, who I think was the squadron leader on the raid into Goose Green at the Falklands.
Wow.
Me, as a then 45-year-old PPL, which was who'd amounted to very little, was chatting to the lead pilot of the raid on the Falkland Islands,
The black
and
tower.
he was asking me questions.
Yeah.
And that blew my mind. And it was just that at that very moment, I got so much out of that that I thought, well, I don't, if I die now, I'm happy. The build was almost ready. I'd spent time with all these wonderful people, and my life was complete. Fast forward a little bit more, however, what happened to the project then is we started off with about 30 or 40 kids, but we came down to a hardcore of about 15. And what we realized with the 15 is that they were the people with the passion and the desire to not only learn to fly, but they developed a passion for building and construction. These were people who would probably never thought previously about cutting, measuring, designing, working in the machine shop, working with metals, working with riveters, working with aircraft coatings and skins. But they were now doing leather work, plastic work, metal work, woodwork. They were learning how to put an engine together. They were learning how to wire an aircraft. And they were learning how to design a prop, how to fit a prop, how to put a spinner on, how to put wheels on, how to make brakes work. Because literally they had to put the brakes together, even including the cylinders. They were doing all this on their own, but we're obviously with adult supervision. But there were no adults coming along and saying, "We'll do it for you." They were coming along and saying, "You need to do this," and they would do it. And I just there were people there. The one or two people, I don't mind saying, were probably a little bit too large, shall we say, to fly the aircraft later on, and they knew it. But they discovered something that they could do, and they threw themselves headlong into this. And then the project eventually we got it test flown from Finningley, and it was on BBC Radio. Not it was on BBC One in the north, actually on the television. So the test flight was shown on the telly. Load of more sponsors came in from the back of that, and they funded the aircraft for the next 4 or 5 years. And over that 4 or 5 years, understood. Over the next 4 or 5 years, we flew pretty much everybody in that aircraft.
So, I mean, one of the things that got me when I met the Spirit of Gould team was one of the team spirit, which sounds very corny, but it was genuinely there. But it was also the variety of things. It wasn't just the technical side of things. There was the marketing and the sales and the artwork and all these other skills which were aviation related, but not what you would instantly think of as being aviation. It was, well, anybody needs sales and marketing. Well, yes, but if you haven't got the passion for it, as you mentioned, as a salesman, if you believe in something, then it's much easier to sell something. And just these kids having this passion for the project, no matter which part of the project they were doing, it seemed to me they just glowed. You know, they were just,
They
yeah,
did.
it was very, very, very special. And that stuck with us. And I've kept, well, we at Swift Aircraft, we've kept in touch with a few of the kids. You know, we're on social media and that sort of thing. And I'm actually interviewing one of them on Friday. I'm
I'm
sure
going
you
to guess
didn't
that's
know.
Michelle.
Yes, it is. So she is quite interesting. So she's got a story to tell. So I'd be very interested to see her side of your part of that story. So that's good. So I've got two quick questions just to sort of round off, because this half hour is nearly gone and it's
That's
shot by,
incredible.
right? It's
Sorry.
absolutely no. That's the thing. Is you think half an hour, how am I going to talk for half an hour? And all of a sudden it's bam. So the future, where do you see the future going? I'll give you 3 minutes on that one. So aviation, so you talked about program with the start of 1903 and how flying and all started. Where do you see things going in the future?
I think we're all aware that commercial aviation is becoming highly automated. I've often thought that maybe in sort of 20 or 30 years, or even less than that, we won't need pilots. And those of us that know a lot about flying, or those of us that claim to know a lot about flying, know that in many instances right now, you could actually fly without pilots, but the public kind of require them there. However, I think there's some developments coming along, particularly in terms of supersonic or even hypersonic flight, that in 50 years' time we'll see a resurgence, or in 30 years' time we'll see a resurgence in different types of flying that will require highly competent, very skilled pilots to keep these things going. Commercial flying for the next 20 years at least will always still have pilots because that's what the public demand. So in terms of the medium-term future for commercial flying, I think it's solid and stable, and I think it's becoming more affordable. I think from light aviation, what's going to control that or dictate it is going to be two things. One is different fuel types. As we run out of fossil fuels, we've got to look at different ways of powering aircraft. Allied to that will be the kind of engines that we need. So engineering is going to have to develop, and allied to that is the kind of composite materials that we'll need. We're going to have to build lighter aircraft that can go on lighter machines with more efficient engines that run off electric or biofuels or even hydrogen. So there's lots and lots of opportunity in the future because everything's changing. It's not coming to a halt. It's not coming to a point where it can't progress. It is morphing. It's becoming something completely different. If you look at one thing I'm really enthusiastic about is these guys that build these VTOL aircraft that got like 92 drones around the side, but they fly very, very efficiently. You wouldn't call them an aircraft because they don't look like one. They're just like a flying car. But that's still the future of aviation. So there's always going to be something happening in terms of getting people into the sky, and that will never change. And I believe that'll exist for the whole of humanity.
Right. Okay. And it's funny because a lot of people think of aviation, oh, it doesn't apply to me. But if you took air travel out of it, you take away so much from especially modern life. So it's not just going on holiday, but it's search and rescue, it's freight, it's navigation, the whole shebang. I mean, aviation is more than a 737 to Malaga. So it's but unfortunately, for a lot of people, I think that's all they ever see, and that's part of the reason for this podcast is to try and spread out the view that people have by talking to the people that work and live inside this little community. So it's been fascinating talking to you again, and we shall certainly catch up. The last question that I have is, it seems like a trivial question, but it's not. I'm going to be very interested by the time we get to the end of the series to see what is on the wall of our control tower. So we have somebody else's favorite plane there. I'll tell you what it was after. But what is your favorite aircraft, and what's the one top trump characteristic that you would want to record about it?
I've got so many. I've been fortunate. I've flown over 35 different types of airplane.
Right.
But my personal favorite, simply because of what I got out of it, has to be right now the Jet Provost.
Right.
And the reason for that is I managed to fly one last year for 3.5 hours.
Wow.
And I was at the point where I could take it from cold, fly it, take it around, land it, navigate, and turn it back off again. So I could take it from cold to cold on a complete mission. For somebody like me to be able to do that was incredibly special. Yes, it was expensive, but it was a culmination of everything I'd learned over 30 years of flying, and it all came together. That's one answer. My other answer has got to be the Harrier jump jet.
Okay, interesting.
So it might not have been the first thing that sprung to my mind, but as I sit here thinking about it, and I think of everything to do with engineering, the Harrier jump jet was a British design. The British have always been amongst the best in the world and still are the best in the world at building things that work. It's the old thing, if it looks right, it flies right. The original idea of that concept was mad, but so was the concept of the Lancaster bomber, so was the concept of Concorde. All these concepts originally deemed as mad because the people that designed them as deemed as madmen or mad women. I love that, and that's what I love about aviation, is what it brings out in terms of characters. So my favorite all-time aircraft has to be the Harrier jump jet because of everything it did in terms of vertical takeoff and landing, fast entry into zones, just radicalizing and changing the whole way of thinking of aviation. And then one final thing I'm going to stick in is an airship. I think the future, a lot of the future of aviation could be in large cargo carrying airships. So if you want to look for a future favorite aircraft, that could be it.
Okay, interesting, interesting. So out of those three, you're gonna have to pick one to go on the board. Go on.
On the board, purely for selfish reasons, stick a Jet Provost Mark III.
Power Smart 3. Okay, good. Yes, that's lovely. I wondered if you were going to stick with the Harrier there because already on the board is the Harrier. So we're opening up the scope a little bit with the Provost, which I never got to fly in when I was in the Cadets myself. I never made it that far, but I did do a chipmunk. So
Oh, well, the chippy, I've been fortunate to go in a chippy as well.
they're lovely. They're bigger than you
Actually,
think.
very briefly, I think one of my favorite aircraft to fly was the Yak 52.
Now that's a beast though. That's a
That was a beast. 12 cylinder radial engine. And the pilot I was looking to fly with says, right, said, what are you like with aeros? Oh, not a problem. So we did a display over the top of an airfield in York, near York. And at one point in time, we pulled 9 Gs. And I remember the intercom in a Yak is a push to transmit even front to back. You can't hear each other until you push to transmit. And I've got this crackling overhead. Like, you're still with us, mate? Yep, still here. And I won't repeat what he said because this might go out broadcast.
Excellent, excellent. So, with that, so I'm going to wrap it up. You have come from humble beginnings. You have been mentored and introduced to flying at an early age. You have developed your skills and flown a variety of aircraft. You've got involved with a whole mentoring program of STEM and young person development, and you're still involved. You're still working with the air cadets. You're still teaching people to glide and to fly.
Kind of, yeah. The Vigilant was grounded some years ago. So at that point in time, my old squadron disbanded. But then I've rejoined 645 EGS at Topcliffe recently.
Right.
And whilst I'm still on probation, because I've only just gone back into it because those are the rules, I am back in a glider. I am back working with young people. And at the moment, I'm having a competition to see who can actually run fastest down the airfield to catch glider. Because I tend to be beating the 18-year-olds, but the 14-year-olds are still trashing me. And it's just this. I've got this fortunate thing of spending time just chatting to people who've got this passion. And I think when you talk to young people, and even in 2023, they've got the same ambitions and ideas and thoughts that I had back in 1983 or 1973. I just find that so reassuring. And it just makes me think that at least I did something right in my life. And that was sticking at it, wanting to do it, being determined to do it. But then having the good fortune to be able to pass it on to somebody else.
And these days, you're still seeing lots of little Chris Milnes running around and starting their journey.
Sadly, yeah.
Okay, well, Chris, I'm going to wrap it up there. We're just about out of time. Thank you very much for your time and your enthusiasm.
Been a pleasure. I could have gone on for hours. I do apologize.
Well, no, don't apologize. This is what we want. So you have an open invitation to come visit us down at RAF Coltishall, where Swift Aircraft are based. So if you ever want to come down with any of your guys, then let me know. We'll make that happen.
Absolutely. Well, I mean, I'd like to come down myself and just see how you're doing with that wonderful airplane. I remember when you first showed me the design back at Sewell all those years ago. I mean, I won't tell people what it looks like in terms of my opinion, but the elliptical wing is very reminiscent of something rather fabulous. But then the concepts you had and the progress you're making with it now and the opportunities you've got with that aircraft are wonderful. And you deserve to make that get and deserve to make that happen.
Well, we'll make sure you get up in one as well. You can add that to your list.
Sold.
Oh, you're on. So, Chris Mills, thanks very much for joining us, and I will speak to you sometime soon.
McLean of Swift Aircraft, it's been my pleasure. Thank you.
Okay, so take it easy.
Cheers.
Bye. So that was Chris Milnes, a man who started with low expectations and small horizons in life, who now opens up the skies and the world for the next generations by showing what can be done with the right mindset. His passion is contagious, his motives altruistic, and his sense of fun and adventure an example to many. I know from personal experience the impact he has made on the next generation, some of whom we'll talk with soon here on The Short Circuit. So, my dear listener, I hope you got the flavour of Chris's story. He has a lot more to tell, including lifting and dropping skydivers, but that is for another day. But I think that you'll agree with me that here is a man that saw his chance and grabbed it with both hands. From being shown the way, he now shines that light for the next wave, leading by example and living the hashtag inspiring aviation. I hope you enjoyed the chat and that you'll join me again here on the next Short Circuit. Fly safe. You have been listening to The Short Circuit, presented by Mike McLean and sponsored by Swift Aircraft with the hashtag Inspiring Aviation. This has been a Zoom Spike production.